G'day, I'm Mel Leyland. Come and join us on a caravanning adventure around Australia. My wife, Laraine, will share her travel recipes with you.
We're filming everything as it happens. Our daughter, Carmen, and her husband, Robert, complete the team.
We'll explore the whole country and meet its people.
The experience of a lifetime.
Our countryside is on display. Pack up your caravans. We'll travel.
On this leg of our journey, we leave Porcupine Gorge in central Queensland and travel east to the rugged White Mountains, where the traditional owners explain these ancient tribal markings. We visit the gold mining regions of Charters Towers and Ravenswood, then head north to go underground in tunnels of hardened lava. We'll take an outback train ride, dig up our own topaz, swim in nature's hot spa, go boating, and in the Gulf of Carpentatria, we'll cook up a feast of prawns for a Christmas you'll never forget. This is Porcupine Gorge, a jagged erosion scar slicing through flat basalt-capped plains, and is often known as Australia's Little Grand Canyon. Perched on the precipitous edge of the canyon, our team makes ready to explore the ancient land a little further to the east in the sandstone ranges of the White Mountains. These mountains contain some rugged country, which is the ancestral land of the Gujjalup people. Vince Reed, his sister Patsy, and her husband Cordy lead us down from the plateau to a sacred part of their tribal grounds. There is no track to follow. It's about 2 kilometres to the Flinders River below. Our objective is beyond our range of vision, concealed by a protruding escarpment on the horizon, a round trip of 14 kilometres. It's hot, hard work just to reach the river level. And once we reach the base of the Flinders River, we've got to take our shoes off and cross it. The cool, flowing waters are welcome in the summer heat. Vince can't resist a chance to cool off.
By noon, we stop on the banks of the river for a short lunch break and a welcome respite from the heat. We have a long way to go to reach the sacred grounds, which Vince tells us are decorated with rare rock engravings known as petroglyphs. If we're to reach the engravings and walk out again in one day, we can't afford to rest for long. Our guides have not visited this part of their tribal land for many years. Vince leads us along the water-impregnated sandy bed of Wall Creek. Occasional treks along the high sandstone rock cliffs which line the banks are a welcome change. All too soon we're back in the waterlogged sand.
Eventually, we reach a large flat expanse of sandstone, which in another age was the meeting place for two tribes.
These markings here represent the trading between the two tribes, from the east and the west. What we have over here, the stone axe tools that were traded for Gujjalup boomerangs to be exchanged between the two tribes. And this is the main boundary, this creek bed that runs all the way down to the far end of the junction.
So this is all your country
over this one?
And these two images here of women, which if I hadn't had you here, I'd have said they were men.
Yeah.
This is to do with an exchange of two women.
Promising to a member of that tribe. So they would be giving as bride.
With uplifted spirits, Vince extols the tribal interpretation of the abundant petroglyphs. He soon engrosses himself in traditional music, using his didgeridoo and clapsticks.
Let the Leylands show you the way.
We leave Hughenden and head east towards Charters Towers. Along the way, we pass once more through the White Mountains in the Burra Range. This is the only spot where the White Mountains are easily viewed from the Flinders Highway. From here, Robert investigates the exposed white rock from which the mountains derived their name. We pause for lunch, moving on to the gold town of Charters Towers, 130 kilometres away.
This is the exact spot where a young Aboriginal by the name of Jupiter Mossman was reputed to have discovered the first gold in what is now known as Charters Towers.
In December 1871, Jupiter left an exploration party headed by his adopted father Hugh Mossman to retrieve the pack horses which had been startled by lightning. He returned with his glistening find, and the gold field suddenly grew from the wilderness. Hopeful prospectors came in such numbers, and the gold proved to be so plentiful that Charters Towers quickly became the second largest town in Queensland. It even had its own stock exchange. Many fine brick and stone buildings survive today as testimony to the glories of the golden days. In time, the gold gave out, and the thriving city of over 30,000, known affectionately as the Towers, shrank to the present population of about 8,000.
From the Towers, we head toward another nearby gold mining town, Ravenswood. Have these roadside steel towers been mistaken as trees by nearsighted black ravens? Perhaps they just offer high-rise accommodation with little risk of lizards raiding their eggs.
3 years before gold was discovered at Charters Towers, a cattleman scooped up a drink from the Elphinstone Creek to slake his thirst and found it to be gleaming with gold. Ravenswood soon developed into a shanty town of prospectors. The diggings were so successful that a large number of magnificent buildings replaced the tent town. Today they represent excellent examples of pioneering architecture. There are some pubs around here which have long since served their last drink, and their steps now lead to nowhere. Sorry, Robert, there's no plan to reopen. From the veranda of the old courthouse, we have a great view of the last remaining church. According to two priests who once slept there, it's haunted by the ghost of one of its former ministers. Or had they sampled too much of the communion wine? The old courthouse serves as a museum today, complete with its own colourful caretaker, Woody, who loves to spin a yarn.
In the early 1960s, a man by the name of Pritchard bought these three buildings. He moved them 80 kilometres away, down to near where the Burdekin Dam is today. Before he moved into this building, he had an accident. He never lived in this building. Nobody did. It sat there for approximately 24 years doing absolutely nothing. In 1987, when they built the Burdekin Dam, the dam waters were going to destroy it. So he picked it up and brought it back, put it on the same site where it was built in 1884. So to me, that makes the most unique courthouse in the world.
Some buildings around here, though, are neither ruins nor museums. They're still in use. The schoolhouse, built in 1873, has never been moved and has never closed. At the back of the school is this dried-up swimming pool. This is rather unique. It was actually built in the 1920s, and it was built because the children were asked to bring to school a brick every day. Of course, there were heaps of these bricks lying around the old mine workings. When they had enough bricks, the parents and the teachers got together and constructed the swimming pool. To see this and many other relics from the past, we take a walk over one of five colour-coded self-guided walking trails which have been clearly marked for visitors to follow.
These information boards are at all the points of interest. And there is plenty of interest at Ravenswood for anyone who likes to potter about old ruins. The rusting relics from the Mabel Mine Stamper are silent reminders that these hills once clamoured with the sounds of industry and the hustle and bustle of over 5,000 people. The men may have gone when the gold ran out, but plenty of their defunct machinery remains.
Not all the gold has gone, and in recent times a second boom has come to Ravenswood. A modern plant using heavy equipment and advanced techniques of extraction have made it possible to win remarkably small quantities of the yellow metal from hard grey rock. First, a massive hole is dug by blasting and digging with huge diggers. Then the rock is loaded into 85-ton dump trucks and carted away to make a small mountain. Seems a bit odd, really. But soon a loader will demolish this recently created mountain of rock and drop it into a crushing plant. The pulverised rock travels by conveyor belt to a processing plant where it is treated with lime, cyanide and oxygen, and all to extract just 1/7 of 1 gram of gold from each tonne of rock. We decide to camp overnight in the showground, where powered sites complete with town water have been provided by the council to serve the needs of travellers. Our day in Ravenswood draws to a close. Although the sun may have set on the golden boom days of the past, these rusting reminders of them will remain for a long time yet. Let the Leylands show you the way. North of the goldfields, we follow the Kennedy Developmental Road before heading down a side track to Red Falls.
Situated on private property, Red Falls are formed where Lulworth Creek tumbles over what is known as the Great Basalt Wall. The owners have thoughtfully provided a steel stairway to their base. Recent storms preceding the monsoon season have fed enough water into the creek to produce a worthwhile cascade. Our next destination is a cattle station, which has opened its doors to travellers recently by offering farm stays. At Bluff Downs, we are greeted by our hosts, Rhonda Smith and her daughter, Celeste. Here accommodation comes in a variety of styles to suit a variety of budgets. The Ringers' quarters offer basic bedrooms and self-cooking facilities in an old cookhouse, which, judging by the size of the storeroom, must have been a busy place when the 400 square kilometre property was run by a pastoral company with plenty of help. This used to be a pantry, and you could only go to town 2 or 3 times a year, and they had to store everything that they thought they'd need. For $100 a day, it's possible to rent one of the main homestead bedrooms and partake of home-cooked meals in the evening at the formal dining room. Here's a chance to taste the relaxed lifestyle enjoyed by some of Australia's elite pastoral pioneers. Visitors can relax with their host or meet the livestock.
I think he must like that.
When I stop. Unlike most suburban families, the Smiths could never be happy with just a dog.
A bit big to play with like this.
The range of friendly animals extends from overgrown potty calves to orphaned fawns. This young deer is a direct descendant of a handful released by the pioneering Hand family, which settled here on the Basalt River over a century ago.
A farm stay at Bluff Downs offers something to suit everybody. It could be as simple as just walking along the banks of the river and enjoying the tranquility. It could be watching some cattle being worked, or maybe it's horse riding. But there's a great variety here. Laraine and I choose to spend a quiet hour in the old meat house, which serves, somewhat ironically, to house the 10,000-year-old bones of an extinct rhinoceros-sized animal called a diprotodon. They're grass eaters and have pouches for their babies, just like today's kangaroos and other marsupials. They were found quite near the homestead.
While Mum and Dad relax with their old bones... Oops, sorry, I didn't mean you, Mum. Robert and I are quick to lend a hand to Celeste, who needs to yard these young weaners into several pens for the night. We've never handled cattle before and find it a bit frightening at first, but soon get the hang of it and find ourselves loving the opportunity to get a taste of real station work. What a way to end our day on a working cattle station. Let the Leylands show you the way.
We head north from Bluff Downs, following the course of the Burdekin River. This region was first described by early European explorers who battled the weather, the unfamiliar terrain, and attacks from native tribes in their quest of discovery. Large flightless emus, huge majestic brolgas, and a multitude of unknown plants must have imparted an exotic element to their great adventures. Our great adventure is a far cry from the arduous undertakings of Australia's earliest explorers, but the rugged landscape, tall, ghost-like gum trees and abundant wildlife are every bit as enthralling. We establish camp on the banks of the Burdekin River, along with thousands of raucous galahs. These noisy but colourful parrots are just one of the many which give Australia the distinction of having more parrot species than any other country on the planet. Because of their comical behaviour, the word galah has come to mean a clown in Aussie folklore. On this part of its long journey south, the Burdekin seems to be little more than a creek, but its banks offer tranquil, shady respite from the summer heat. Appearances can be deceptive. The river swells beyond its banks with the monsoonal rains every summer and surges across thousands of kilometres of flat ground. These huge paperbark trees, bent by the annual floodwaters, must be hundreds of years old to reach this size.
This is not just a great place to camp amongst these massive paperbarks, but it's also where explorer Ludwig Leichhardt came in 1844.
On his journey of exploration and those of others which followed, this section of the Burdekin was noted for this unique feature. The banks of this ancient river once flowed with molten lava. The black basalt hardened on the riverbank like a concrete liner. In places, the swirling lava set, retaining the appearance of whipped cream. The basalt is honeycombed where thousands of gaseous bubbles were trapped within the lava. This region of Australia has experienced a lot of volcanic activity in recent geological times.
It's now December, and early wet season storms which precede the monsoons are a daily occurrence. As we arrive at Undara National Park, we could be excused for thinking we'd stumbled upon a derailed train. However, these carriages have been deliberately placed here and converted to accommodation. Visitors come to Undara to see unusual tunnels known as lava tubes. For those on tighter budgets, the Undara Lodge offers these permanently erected tents with wooden floors, or sites for self-contained travellers like us. Whatever the accommodation, the facilities of the lodge are open to all.
Robert and I cook up a quick barbecue in the evening, in readiness for our tour of the volcano-dotted landscape first thing in the morning. The only way to view the unique lava tubes is by guided tour. Our guide is Thomas Atkinson.
Hey, all those hills you see out there on the horizon are volcanoes. There's 164 volcanoes in this province, and you can see about eight out there in front of you. There's two different types of volcanoes. You've got pyroclastic volcanoes and shield volcanoes. The pyroclastic ones are the ones with the steep sides, the shield volcanoes with the long sloping sides. So over the far right-hand side you can see Racecourse, that's a shield volcano. And on the far left-hand side there's Rangaranga, which is a cinder cone, which is one that produces heaps of rocks and ash, but no lava.
It's lava that we've come to see, or to be more precise, the solidified outer shell of lava which forms these tunnels. During volcanic eruptions 190,000 years ago, enormous volumes of molten lava flowed along ancient riverbeds in the granite, similar to that which we saw in the Burdekin. Here, however, the lava remained as a liquid and continued to flow. As water flows through a pipe, so the molten river of fire drained from the tubes, leaving behind these extensive tunnels.
These up here are tree roots, and they've come down from a tree that's growing on top of the tube. And it sends down its root system down into the tube to get the moisture off the ceiling, which comes from the condensation from the warm air rising and touching the ceiling.
This multicoloured wall gets its array of coloured deposits from various minerals which have been dissolved by rainwater seeping through from the surface. These tunnels are the longest in the world, extending over 160 kilometres.
The tunnels are not continuous, and it's only where the roof has collapsed that access to the tubes is possible. Part of the excitement is knowing that where we are walking is where fiery cauldrons of molten rock once surged so many years ago. The vegetation which grows in these collapsed sections of roof is unique too. The plants are not resistant to fire like most of Australia's flora and have been preserved in isolated pockets like a living museum from the prehistoric past.
We conclude our day by lashing out on a full a la carte dinner in the dining carriage back at the lodge. Well, we do have a special reason to. It's our wedding anniversary today. Mel and I have been married for 29 years, and although we've spent most of our time travelling, this is the last place we expected to be celebrating it.
Who whipped out this and did this? Let the Leylands show you the way.
Our journey takes us west from the lava tubes to Karumba in the Gulf of Carpentatria. Next stop, Mount Surprise.
At the caravan park, Carmen and I take time out to inspect these miniature horses, which the owner of the park breeds professionally. They look like cute little pets, but they are fully grown horses and require the same amount of attention as full-sized ones. Except, of course, they don't eat as much. We take the opportunity to plan the next stage of our trip. It's amazing how many things we can find in and around Mount Surprise. It's important when doing this to make sure we're consulting the latest up-to-date brochures for our information. Roads change and new places are opening all the time. We decide to leave the caravan and camper in Mount Surprise and head about 40 kilometres north to the O'Brien's Creek gem fields. The trek can become impassable in wet weather, but so far the summer storms are leaving us alone.
At the fields, we make our way to a corrugated iron dwelling, which, complete with the paraphernalia of a typical Australian miner's camp, gives the impression that this could be the home of a hermit. Inside, we meet the occupant, Sam. He shows us what raw, uncut topaz looks like, then takes us to his diggings. The main finds, which come from O'Brien's Creek, are gem-quality topaz.
Well, on and off, I started in 1983. And then from 83, I could only get a couple of weeks off work. Then it's only last year that I shipped it up here permanently. I like this. You know, there's nobody to annoy you. You haven't got the hustle and bustle of the towns. Or you get the cans there, it's like a blooming madhouse now. I don't think I can cop that anymore.
For $10, Sam allows weekend fossickers like us to try a hand at gem mining. Since the stones occur at random, the only method which works is to dig out the gravel by hand and put it all through a sieve. The trick is to recognise it when you see it. Sam casts his experienced eye over the first few shovel loads, then leaves us to see if we can find them ourselves. The thrill of the first one spurs us on.
Oh, here's one!
There are no guarantees, but within a few hours we do have a handful.
Mum found the first one, but as the day moves on, I'm lucky enough to find the biggest stone. We take it just 10 minutes away to the digger's rest, where we have it appraised for cutting by gem cutter Peter Blackburn.
Basically, we're talking about 27 carats here, about 5.5 grams. So yeah, we should be able to get a 10 millimetre stone out of that.
Peter is an expert and starts by grinding the first of our anti-flat surfaces that will make up the complex facets of this finished gem.
Okay,
you have a look on here, see I've got two, I don't know if you can see them, I've got two triangular facets which now they meet at the bottom like that.
The manner in which the facets are polished and geometric symmetry of each gem gives them their individuality. And this is my very own unique topaz. It may only be worth a few hundred dollars, but it'll always have special meaning because we dug it out ourselves.
The destination for the second half of our day is a further 80 kilometres away on Tallaroo Station. Here a natural spring gushes forth with superheated water and has done so for centuries. There are a number of outlets. The Tallaroo hot springs were discovered by a passing mailman in 1870. Since then it has been the site of a hotel and horse-drawn coach stop. The mineral-laden water is 74 degrees at the hottest outlet. A dog once jumped in and died from the scalds. Its owner spent a long time recovering in hospital after trying to save his canine mate. The minerals devour anything in their path, enveloping trees, fence posts and hapless lizards which get in the way.
The owners have erected a kiosk and shelter complete with changing rooms, for not all the water is too hot to swim in. This pool, designed to capture the water at 38 degrees, provides a natural spa. What a way to wash away the dust of a day's topaz mining.
Next day, we board the Savannahlander at Mount Surprise and take a ride on what is proclaimed to be the last great train ride. This two-carriage motor rail has no locomotive. It's propelled by an inbuilt diesel engine and passes through the sleepy town of Mount Surprise just once a week. This section of railway line was constructed by a mining company commencing in 1906. The intention was to take it through to the gold mining town of Georgetown, but it never reached that far. Hundreds of men toiled in harsh conditions to build the line by hand. It was a tough job and a great feat of engineering. Family life for workers on the line was basic, and for many single men, the grog shops ended up with most of their hard-earned money. The tiny town of Charleston is where the line ended and still ends today. The name was changed later to Forsyth. The Savannahlander is strictly a tourist ride now and keeps a very flexible schedule.
One of the good things about travelling on the Savannahlander is that you don't have to do any of the driving. You can just sit back and relax. Have a drink, thanks. It's really very easy. Not a bad way to go, is it?
Yeah, not bad for those with a personal servant.
Now, come on, darling, you know I was only kidding, don't you?
Like this, you mean?
Well, not exactly. I suppose if I wanted to be a chauvinist pig, I should have started 29 years ago. Good stuff. All right. Enough of that frivolity.
Our train driver is happy to stop at any point of interest along the way, such as this old rail workers' camp. Here, two unnamed graves, fringed with stones, mark the last resting place of some who found the country too harsh. Rusting artefacts of their daily lives litter the ground.
Something London, 40 matches.
Soon we resume travel and are glad of the chance to escape the 40 degree heat with a gentle breeze wafting through the windows of the train. We cross the Copperfield River to arrive at the only town on the line, the old copper mining town of Ainslie. Since the closure of its last hotel, it can now only boast of the pub with no beer. We stop for 45 minutes, time enough to inspect the relics of the past and partake of homemade cakes and tea served at the wooden rail siding.
Yes.
riding the Savannahlander is not just about catching the train and enjoying the experience of the countryside you go through. It's also an opportunity to meet people from all over the world, your fellow passengers.
Hi, we're from Toronto, Canada.
And I'm Tori.
And I'm Dana, and we're having a great time.
From Lincoln in England. It's about 120 miles north of London.
Well, I'm from Germany. I migrated in 1983 to Australia.
I'm coming from Germany.
I come from Ireland. I'm working in Brunei at the present time and on holidays in Australia. This is Regina. Say hello, Regina.
Hello. I'm from the Philippines.
And oddly enough, we even have a few Aussies on board too, including Alan Barrett, our driver. Alan pauses to show us an old native waterhole once used by Aborigines as a reliable source of drinking water in the dry, harsh summers. He'll stop to show us anything, including culverts or wildflowers. How's this for a cockroach, Laraine?
Keep it out of my kitchen, please.
The closer we get to Forsyth and the end of the line, the more mountainous the country becomes. This is the Newcastle Range, which tested the determination and craftsmanship which the railway engineers used to reach the old goldfields. Another feature of these hills are the tiny and timid rock wallabies. These frail members of the kangaroo family have come to know the sound of the train once a week and shyly emerge from the undergrowth to greet the train. Drivers throw these wary creatures a few food pellets on each trip to the delight of all the passengers. Forsyth, the end of the line, and for us an overnight stop in the pub. But first we take a sunset tour to the nearby Castle Rock to watch the sun go down on another great day in the outback. Ominous thunderstorms on the horizon serve once more to remind us that the monsoon season is soon to start. We'll take the train back to Mount Surprise in the morning and continue to the Gulf of Carpentatria.
Let the Leylands show you the way.
After returning by train to Mount Surprise, we resume driving and head south to a cattle station named Robin Hood. The sprawling cattle property provides access to a narrow but spectacular gorge known as Cobbled Gorge. The gorge can only be reached by guided tours, which are operated by Gay and Simon Terry. We leave our vehicles in their camping village and join Simon for a tour of the gorge. He uses his especially built four-wheel drive bus to take us along the bed of the Robertson River, stopping along the way to visit the grave of a murdered traveller, John Corbett.
John was actually a carrier. He was travelling from Western Creek over to a place called Gilberton, and these were very small townships which existed back in the 1870s. John was carrying in his pack bags, on his pack horses, a considerable amount of gold. And so when John was actually found here by the old wagon track where the vehicle is, they discovered that a portion of the gold was actually missing.
Although Corbett died from a spear wound, it's thought that he was murdered by bushrangers as the gold was of no use to wild blacks.
This is Cobble Creek here in front of us, and the water level you see there now is permanent. The water level never gets below this level, and remains there all throughout the dry season, enabling us to do boat cruises up the gorge, but also a pretty good little habitat for fish and bird life in the area as well.
A harmless legless lizard, disturbed by our passing, scurries for cover. The small boat moves almost silently along the 6 kilometre narrow canyon of rock, powered by an electric outboard. In the wet season, the water rises a further 5 or 6 metres, effectively closing down the opportunity for boating until the next dry season. It is now late December, and this is about the last chance to see it before the rains come. Cobbled Gorge is up to 30 metres high in places and is one of many such narrow fissures carved through this 190 million year old block of sandstone.
The gorge is also home to freshwater crocodiles. We don't see any, but Simon assures us they are here.
What happened? Oh, Shimanda. Hello.
According to the book, freshwater crocodiles are harmless to humans. It's over 40 degrees, so we cool off. We just hope the crocodiles have read the book too.
Back on the track, another afternoon thunderstorm threatens, but it soon becomes the least of our worries.
Looks like it's time for lunch now.
It's having a nice snooze too.
The tyre is suffering a stone rupture, so while the girls get lunch ready, I re-inflate it to find the damage. Mal reckons a good quality battery-operated compressor is more important to carry than a winch. I couldn't agree more in this heat. We plug the hole and quickly find ourselves driving through that storm to reach Georgetown. Here, with the lightning still flashing in the evening sky, the setting sun turns the angry storm clouds into a spectacle of colour.
With morning, the storm has passed. We must always be mindful that at this time of the year, we should be prepared to change our plans if flooding occurs.
Most of the road between Croydon and Normanton is sealed, so reaching the Gulf should now be a breeze. Normanton, home of purple pubs and big barramundi, the most popular fish in this part of the world.
I knew they were big, but this is ridiculous.
Speaking of big, this is a life-size model of the biggest crocodile ever caught.
Quick clowning about, Robert. Let's move on to Karumba.
Another storm up ahead, Robert.
Might want to be a bit of a big one tonight.
Yep, getting more frequent every afternoon now.
We'd reach Karumba and set up camp in the Sunset Caravan Park at Karumba Point. The point is on the northern banks of the Norman River, which runs into the Gulf of Carpentatria. At this time of the year, the fishing fleet is sheltering from the anticipated storms. All is quiet. With Christmas only 2 days off, a quiet, laid-back mood soon overtakes us too. And the sunsets, famous all over the world, don't let us down. It's Christmas Eve, so we treat ourselves to a helicopter flight over the Gulf. Karumba and Karumba Point are sizeable communities deriving their income from fishing and tourism. Over 60,000 tourists visit Karumba each dry season, and most come for the fishing. Here is where vast expanses of tidal mudflats, mangroves and long sandy spits combine to produce a different and distinctive coastline. With huge 10-metre tides, thousands of square kilometres of coastal flatlands are inundated every day. Already the heavy rainfall from tropical storms have dumped millions of litres of torrential rain into these mudflats. The waterlogged land is now accessible only to those with wings, and these majestic pelicans have some of the biggest wings in the business. Flooded creeks fringed with mangroves creep through the inundated landscape like veins of drowned vegetation. The Gulf of Carpentaria is unique, a weird watery world where the land melds with the sea. At this time of the year, it's hot and humid too.
Christmas Day turns out to be hot, but that doesn't stop us from celebrating. Our tree is a gum tree, and the presents appear like magic from their hiding places in the vans. Here in the fishing capital of the Gulf, a seafood Christmas seems appropriate.
We're preparing our own Christmas feast. Here we have two Gulf mud crabs, fresh ones, also green prawns that have been marinated in a spicy sauce, freshly caught tiger prawns, rather large chicken that has been stuffed and we're going to roast it and serve it with the mangoes in a mango and chicken salad. And we'll be using these potatoes to make a potato salad.
We cook the crabs for 15 minutes in boiling salt water and we'll serve them and the prawns with a seafood sauce.
To make the seafood sauce, I'm using 2 tablespoons of tomato sauce, 1 dessert spoon of Worcestershire sauce, 1 dessert spoon of white vinegar. Stir that around a little bit, and while you're doing that, add a couple of dashes of Tabasco sauce, your dried mustard, and mix that well. And then gently add the fresh cream. If you're travelling and if you don't have fresh cream, just use tinned cream.
For dessert, we're having a trifle.
To make the trifle, the first thing I do is put jam on the sponge fingers or the sponge cake. The idea is to line the sides and the bottom of the bowl with the sponge fingers. Now I'll add a little claret to the biscuits. Not very much. It just adds a little bit of flavour. Next, I'll add some raspberry jelly that's been all broken up with a fork. Now I'll add the custard. Just spread it around. To this, I add a little bit of fruit salad that's been drained. Then add a little bit more jelly and some custard. Now I'll top it with some whipped cream. Finish it off with slices of mango and some fresh passion fruit. A traditional Aussie trifle.
Carmen cooks the marinated prawns for just a few minutes in a wok before serving them hot. Not a lot of cooking really, which is just as well on such a warm day.
It's 35 degrees and this is our Christmas feast. Freshly cooked mud crabs, chicken and mango salad, prawns with seafood sauce, potato salad, spicy prawns, and an Aussie trifle for dessert.
And the results are delicious. Not bad for Christmas in the bush, is it? To cap off the perfect Christmas dinner, a perfect sunset in the Gulf of Carpentaria. What better way to end this leg of our great caravanning adventure? The fire of sunset, the waters of Carpentaria. Next on Leyland's Australia, we head north for the wet season.
You usually get these big storms in the afternoon.
The best way to appreciate the expansive scale of the gorge system is from the air.
They're not supposed to bite, but I'm not really sure.
Monsoon rains have transformed the country into a carpet of green. Next on Leyland's Australia.
Countryside is on display. Pack up your carrot.
For great travel information, why not collect Leyland's Australia, the magazine? A new one will be in your newsagents every 3 months. If you like our TV shows, you'll love the magazine.
Leyland's Australia, great Aussie holidays. Australia, let the Leylands show you the way. The Leyland's. We'll show you Australia. Let the Leylands show you the way.